Good morning and welcome to First Baptist this morning. We'd ask you to stand and join us as we sing.
Good morning, First Baptist Church. You can go ahead and be seated. Happy Father's Day to all you dads out there. What an exciting day. There's lots of stuff going on today, so I just wanted to welcome you here this morning. I don't know what your plans this afternoon are, whether you're taking your dads out or grandpas out or whatever you're doing. I want to just pray that my blessing upon you. I know my son is coming up to, we're going to meet him in Chemainus for lunch a little later, earlier this afternoon, I guess. But just want to welcome you here this morning. Lots going on, lots of announcements. So Cindy, come and share with us.
The other thing I wish to do is we have three very wonderful gentlemen who have put their names forward to be elders in our congregation. And I would like to invite Gord, Dallin, and Trevor to come up and just introduce themselves.
Good morning. Well, I think most of you know me. I'm Trevor, and I'm on worship team and a few other areas in the church. So yeah, just gonna share how I've been led to this position. So. So my personal plan was to be open for the role of an elder in my 40s or 50s, but it became very evident this past few years that God's been specifically preparing me to serve as an elder for the season, and as I say, it felt important not to pull a Jonah and run from the Lord's clear call. So I've been working my own small business for a few years now, without staff or much interruption during the day. So basically all day long, I get to be in God's word, listening to sermons, biblical commentary, and that wasn't always me in the past. I always loved the Lord, but he's really given me a desire for his word. So he's just given me an earnest desire to seek him and study his word. So I just wanted to share Psalms 1:1-3 as well. How blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He will be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither, and in whatever he does, he prospers. So that's been my experience, just being in the Word through COVID and our church turbulence, as I call it. I've been at total peace and just trusting the Lord and seeing his hand through it all. I wrote here, I wake up each day and I'm excited to get to know him more deeply and share the truth of the gospel with others. And I found myself at peace, and I wanted to share James 4:8 about drawing. When you draw near to God, he will draw near to you. And spent a good bit of time studying what the Bible says about the role and standards of elders, and I feel that I'm up to the challenge, but only in the Lord's strength because of time spent with him these past few years. And I try to live my life fully available for the Lord's work, and it's been a joy to serve him in our church and elsewhere over the years. And I look forward to encouraging this church to stand for God and his word in the years to come.
Well, this is where the younger generation hits the older generation. Trevor's got his cell phone. I got a piece of paper. Because if I had my cell phone, I'd touch the screen and it would go to wherever they go, and I would never find it again. Well, good morning, church family. For those that don't know me, my name is Gord Biernes, and I became a member here at First Baptist Church on February the 7th, 1988. And Pastor Lloyd Crawford was our pastor at the time, and we had a letter from the church welcoming us into membership, and the verse that Pastor Crawford gave to me to be my go-to verse was Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And I've proven that over many, many years of difficulties and struggles. And this is a verse that reminded me and continues to remind me that in myself I can do nothing, but in Jesus Christ I can do everything that he wants me to do for him. Elders are not created, appointed, or elected by a vote of a congregational meeting. One does not become an elder by merely filling an office, reading a book, or resolving in one's own mind that this is a task that I will do. God alone makes elders. If spiritual leadership was easy, everyone would be doing it. Spiritual leadership is not a calling that we choose to pursue, but it is a calling that we must choose to answer. We don't decide to become elders, we decide to respond and keep responding to God's call in our lives. And today I'm answering that call, knowing that I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. My greatest desire is to love God, to love people, to proclaim the truth in love, to defend the gospel, and to make disciples by helping our church family grow in their knowledge and faith in Jesus Christ. Hebrews 10:24 encourages us to see the ways that we can spur one another on into love and into good works. And I would love to be a part of that as I see that happening in our congregation now, to spur that on, that growth, that love, the knowledge, and that Jesus' love would be proclaimed throughout our community and through our church family and our homes. I would be honored to serve as an elder. I would love to serve the Lord in this capacity and my church family. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Dallin Hawker, for those of you who don't know me. And when Brian asked us to sort of prepare a reason why we'd like to be elders, I think the short answer for me, and as Gord alluded, is we just feel called by the Lord to do this job. And I think in any role in the church, unless the Lord calls you to do it, you're not the one to be doing it. And but the long answer is I love this church. It might be hard for you to believe, but I've been here 56 years. I was, there's a couple years I was pursuing a girl at the Pentecostal church, but I married her and brought her back here. So, but anyway, I remember this church when I broke my tooth running down the hall in front of the ladies' washroom after my mother told me to not run in the church. I remember going to Brigade Boys Sunday School, summer camp. I remember being a youth leader. I remember being a Sunday school teacher. I was on that a deacon's board before we even had an elder's board. And multiple times I've served on an elder's board. And I just love this church. And I love it not because of the building, because buildings change. I remember when that foyer, it was an open courtyard with shrubs. I remember when there was no balcony in this church or no multi-purpose building. I remember when our parking lot was gravel. So through all that, I love our church. I love our church not because of the building, not even because of the people, although I love the building and I love the people. But I love our church because it's been faithful, like faithful to preach God's word in, as the Bible says, in season and out of season. In the Acts, book of Acts, chapter 20, and I think around verse 28, the Holy Spirit, speaking through Paul, admonishes the leaders and the elders of the church. He says, feed my sheep and guard my sheep. And I think in this day and age that we live as elders, that's one of the most important things we can do, is we don't do what the government tells us to do necessarily. We don't do what society tells us to do. We don't do what's politically correct. We do what this tells us to do. And I'd just like to leave you with this verses in Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2. And it says, preach the word of God, be persistent, whether the time is favorable or not. Patiently correct, rebuke, encourage your people with good teaching. For time is coming when people will no longer listen to right teaching. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever they want to hear. They will reject the truth and follow strange myths. But you should keep a clear mind in every situation. Don't be afraid of suffering for the Lord. Work at bringing others to Christ. Complete the ministry God has given you. Now, does that sound like our culture or what? And just the final image I'd like to leave with you that I think really brings us home to me is back in 1996. I know some of you will remember this. The Saguenay River overflowed in Quebec, and there was one little white house that stood through that whole flood of white buildings and farms and land. They had landslides. And they said the amount of water flowing around that house was equivalent to Niagara Falls. Yet that house is still there to this day. It's now a historical site and a museum. But just in a footnote, I looked back at the articles that they were printing in 1996. And just as one little footnote on the bottom, it said, the owners of this house decided to reinforce the foundation into the bedrock. And I think in the times that are coming, as a church, we need to reinforce our roots and our foundation into the bedrock of truth, truth of the scripture. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you very much, guys. I couldn't be happier to be up here with such wonderful men. I can't tell you how much I love these guys. On Tuesday, we're at our AGM meeting. We are going to vote for these gentlemen, and I'm very excited. By then, Trevor and I will have Psalm 1 memorized.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Oh, God.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, on this day we call Father's Day, we are so grateful that first and foremost, you are our Father. You loved us before we loved you. We thank you, Lord, that you gave many of us the opportunity to be a father. And as fathers, we ask you, Lord, to continue helping and guiding us with the children you have blessed us with. Lord, we also ask your blessing on the upcoming congregational meeting this Tuesday night. May all of us hear your call to attend, to do your business. Bless the decisions we will take. Bless the voting in of the elders and of other positions. Lord, we pray for our country. With so many fires that are still out of control, we'll ask you, Lord, to be with those firefighters, keep them safe, but also with those who have been ordered out of their homes. Give them calm, Lord. We also thank you, Lord, for Pastor Wayne and his wife, Rita. We know and thank them for their continuing blessings in our church family. We thank you, Lord, for the safe arrival of Nadai and her family. We pray that they will settle in quickly in their new environment. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to show our hospitality in helping out where we can and as needed. We pray for our Shellings, Irene Merrifield and Norm Jacobson. We pray for the sick, Sue Gaunt, who will be going to Victoria this week, and Christine Dunham. We also want to pray for our sister Leslie Seltzer, who will undergo an operation this week. We ask you to bless the hands of the surgeon and the nurses that will look after her. Lord, we also want to pray for Knut and Britta Jorgensen, an older couple in our congregation that needs your guidance, your help, your love, your support. We pray for our youth group that meets on Wednesday night. There are many among them who are totally unfamiliar with you, Lord. So we ask you to bless all the leaders for your guidance. Also bless our young adult groups and their leaders. Lord, we now give some private time to share with you, Lord, our own requests. Finally, Lord, bless our tithing and our giving. We pray this all in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, worship team. I couldn't help but notice this morning during the announcements that so much of our morning is focused on the future, isn't it? Just think back to some of the announcements that you heard. Our grads, Nathaniel and Carson, thinking about, you know, not necessarily thinking about their past years in school, but about their future and what they want to do. Carson, or Nathaniel, you're taking a year off. I'm not sure what Carson is doing, but planning, getting prepared for your future. Our AGM, talking about things that are coming up for the future of this church. And with our Ukrainian family just arriving, thinking about their future and getting settled in here in Nanaimo and finding work and all that kind of stuff. And in our search committee, talking about finding a new pastor. Isn't that exciting? You know, and that raises a whole new question for me, right? But I'm okay with that because I know that, you know, that God's got this. Yeah, I'm excited about that, though, thinking about the future and what, you know, what lies in store for Rita and myself moving forward. And, you know, and in our elders, our new candidates for elders, and excited about that. And as Paul mentioned in our prayers this morning, or as he began our prayers, and seeing all these little kids, and they're so cute. I love sitting here in the front row, just watching their faces as they come, and they're our future leaders, you know, thinking about. So, and I wonder, you know, are we prepared for the future? You know, we look at the world today, and, you know, there's so many things going on, and I'm excited this morning because that's my theme. I'm talking about being, getting prepared, getting ready for where you're going. And, you know, how are we ever going to navigate through the changes that are coming? You look at the world today and what's happened, and you think, you know, the future might be pretty scary, right? You think of, you know, artificial intelligence, and that's maybe the next challenge that we face. You know, we all face challenges every day. Last week, I heard about an elderly couple who from this church, who are no longer able to manage on their living on their own, and so they've made the hard decision to move into an extended care facility, supportive housing complex. And you know, it reminded me of the same decision that my mother had to make at the age of 97, when she had to give up her independent living, and what a big adjustment that was for her. You know, one thing that I've learned during my lifetime is not to become too comfortable where you're at, because inevitably situations change. Just think for a minute about how much has changed just in the last year and a half, or just in the last year since, you know, we've come through COVID. Think about the changes that have happened since then. You know, with all the restrictions are associated with that are pretty much gone. I still see a few people when I'm out shopping or whatever, I still see a few people wearing masks, but the majority of us are, it seems that we've moved beyond that. You know, of course, the war in Ukraine has changed the lives of so many people, not just there, but around the world. And, you know, it has the whole world on edge waiting to see what happens next. Political tensions with China have just escalated, right? Interest rates, I don't know if you're in the housing market, but interest rates, let me tell you, if you don't know, that they've doubled pretty much in the last year. And even the church, you know, we sit here today and think about just even 6 or 7 months ago and how much the church has changed in that time. Our culture, whether we like it or not, is changing rapidly. And whether you're 7 or 97, how well we handle the changes that will come tomorrow are often determined by how well we prepare today. And in order to help us prepare for what might lie ahead, I want to change gears a little bit. And for the next number of weeks, through the summer actually, I'm going to be heading in a little bit different direction. I'm stepping back a little bit from the cross-cultural living series that we've been doing. And I want to take a look at the life of Elijah through this summer. Matthew 17, if you remember, tells us the story of the Mount of Transfiguration, where Jesus took a couple of the disciples and he went up on the mountain and he met with God the Father face to face, and Jesus was transformed and he shone like glory, the scripture tells us. But, you know, there also were two other Old Testament figures, Moses and Elijah. And there's been a lot of speculation about why Moses and Elijah were summoned to this meeting, but I can't help think that perhaps their personal experiences somehow qualified them to offer Jesus some encouragement. Remember, Jesus, from this point onward, he was going to the cross. And so I somehow think that their life experiences, the experiences of Moses and Elijah, gave Jesus some encouragement and helped him to prepare for what awaited him in the days ahead. Elijah. There he is. This is a statue of what artists think Elijah looked like. This is on the top of Mount Carmel, where Elijah's famous battle with the prophets of Baal went down. But, you know, that was only one of the scenes. That's probably the story we know Elijah for the best. But that's just one of the scenes that make up the story of Elijah's life. And his story is found in 1 Kings chapters 17 through 19. And that's where we're going to be focusing over the next number of weeks. And what we see there are a series of little vignettes that, when we place them all together, give us the picture of this man who God used in a very powerful way. And Elijah's experience somehow qualified him to be in the presence of Christ up there on the Mount of Transfiguration. Not all of Elijah's life, however, was spent on mountaintop experiences. And as we begin looking at the scene where Elijah first appears in Scripture, we'll see that God often uses the difficulties that people experience to prepare them for where they're going. Let's look at the beginning of Elijah's story in 1 Kings chapter 17, beginning in verse 1. Now Elijah the Tishbite of Tishbe in Gilead said to Ahab, "As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, before whom I stand, there shall be neither dew nor rain these years except by my word." You know, it's interesting that Elijah, who's considered one of the greatest prophets of the Old Testament, he just suddenly appears out of nowhere before one of the wickedest kings of the age. And yet, before his appearance on the stage, we really know very little or absolutely nothing about him. And to understand the context of what was going on, we need to back up a bit to the chapters immediately preceding chapter 17 in 1 Kings. And these events took place during the period of Israel's history known as the Divided Kingdom, the period of the Divided Kingdom. And after King Solomon's reign, there was a civil war that had split the Hebrew people into two kingdoms. In the south, there was Judah, with its capital at Jerusalem. And in the north was the kingdom of Israel, also known as Ephraim, and they had their capital at a place called Shechem. And these chapters in 1 Kings are focused on the northern kingdom of Israel, where there's a succession of tyrant kings that had risen to power through deception, violence, and murder. And 1 Kings 16, verse 29 tells us that a man named Ahab, the son of Omri, became king over Israel, and Ahab reigned for 22 years. And during that period, he was unprecedented in his corruption and his wickedness. And 1 Kings 16, 33 describes him by saying, "Ahab did more to provoke the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger than all the other kings of Israel who were before him." This, to get an idea of how bad Ahab was, the Bible says that his father Omri did more evil than all who were before him. And so along comes Ahab, and he was even worse than his father. And so the scene is set with a picture of this downward spiral of leadership where the whole nation is being dragged down into a state of idolatry and immorality. I wonder, does that sound familiar to us living in 2023 where, you know, it seems that our nation is being dragged down into this state of idolatry and immorality? There might be some relevance here for us, I think. And chapter 16 also tells us that Ahab married a princess named Jezebel from the region of Sidon, where the people worshiped the false god of Baal. Among other things, Baal was revered as the god of storms, and his worshipers believed that he was the one who brought rain and fertility to the land. And something to keep in mind as the story of Elijah unfolds: Baal, the god of storms and rain. And so after marrying Jezebel, Ahab built a temple for her where she could continue to worship Baal as she had done in her homeland of Sidon. But Jezebel wasn't simply satisfied with her private worship, and she insisted on promoting Baal as a replacement for the God of the Israelites, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And so, by all accounts, Jezebel was the very personification of evil, and she used her husband's power to hunt down and persecute and silence any of God's prophets who stood in opposition to her. And her influence moved the people of Israel beyond mere tolerance of other belief systems. It led them right into the widespread and outright idolatry and to the persecution of anyone who proclaimed and stood on biblical truth. And so I think, you know, we can see some relevance to our world today. We live in a culture that has promoted tolerance for the last 50 years, but we've seemed to have moved beyond mere tolerance to the point of embracing and promoting other belief systems, while at the same time, our culture is growing increasingly hostile to the followers of Christ. You know, so these were dark days for Israel. Dark days for God-fearing people, and they were desperate for someone to take a stand for the truth and someone to stand in boldness against Ahab and Jezebel. And that someone, it turns out, was Elijah. And the only thing that we know about Elijah at this point is what verse 1 says in 1 Kings 17. He was a Tishbite from Tishbe in Gilead, which was an area east of the Jordan River. And what seems significant to me is the apparent insignificance of Elijah's past life. Now, he was probably the half tribe of Manasseh. That's where they lived, on the east side of the Jordan River. But Elijah's history, his hometown, his family, everything about him seems to be obscure and little consequence. And I think that might be the point for us, because it's about what God is going to do through Elijah that is important, much more important than his past. And for us, it's critical to remember the same thing, where God wants to take us is more important than where we've been. And if you're willing, God will prepare you for where you're going. And I think that's a message that we all need to hear, that no matter what lies in the future, if we're willing and faithful, God will prepare us no matter what comes. Perhaps it's what Elijah says as he's introduced to us in this passage that really is the most revealing about him than anything else. He says, "As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives before whom I stand." And so it's these words that set the stage for Elijah's story. Even though God's people were under attack and the political situation in Israel was extremely hostile toward them, Elijah was confident that God was very much alive and well. God lives. And this was the message that Elijah was called to declare to a nation who had turned their back on the one true God and had been led into idolatry. He had to find a way to expose Baal as a false god and at the same time reestablish Yahweh to his rightful place as the one true and sovereign God. And so every message that Elijah preached highlighted this truth, that God is alive and well and still on his throne. Have you ever looked at the condition of the world around us and wondered, where is God? Where is God? Doesn't he care about the injustice, the violence, the murder, the killing of innocent people, the lack of morality, the corruption that's going on in the world? You know, during Elijah's lifetime, the same things and much more had been going on for years. And anybody who followed and worshiped the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were being marginalized, harassed, and even killed. And God seemed to be doing nothing about it. And so not unlike today, it seemed that to many people that God was dead, as Nietzsche put it. Where was God? But there are periods of history, and we can go back and look at periods of history where it seems that God is silent. And then all of a sudden, God bursts on the scene, and wow, we realize God was there all along. God wasn't dead. You know, Elijah knew different. He knew that God wasn't dead and that he was well aware of everything going on in Israel. God was alive then, and he's alive now. You know, we might be distressed about the direction our world is headed in, but don't be discouraged. Don't lose faith, because God is alive, and in the end, he will prevail. Not only did Elijah believe that God was very much alive, Elijah lived his life in a way that showed it. He said, "I stand before him." What more did he need to say? I know that God is alive, and I stand before him. To profess that God is alive and to say that you stand before him or to stand in his presence it's a strong expression of faith. For Elijah, it was a good indication that he knew the heart of God and knew what God's purposes were. And for us, there's no greater qualification for following God into the future than being in a faith relationship with him and knowing his heart. You know, we can read the Bible all we want. We can come to church. We can pray faithfully. But that doesn't mean that you've heard God's heart or even been in the presence of God. Knowing God's heart and standing is in his presence goes much deeper than just knowing about God or going through some religious ritual. Knowing God's heart is about knowing him. It's about a relationship. And it's something that we cultivate through time and commitment, and it takes faith. And when we do come to know God's heart, and when we do know his ways and his will, and we can stand before him with a willingness to submit to him, it's then that we have the potential to be used in some remarkable and powerful ways, just like Elijah. Now for the message that Elijah brought. "There shall be neither dew nor rain these years except for my word." That's it. Just a few words. You know, but some of history's most profound and powerful messages have been remarkably short. When Abraham Lincoln gave the Gettysburg Address, it was 2 minutes long. Elijah's message was so short, but it was to the point. He didn't compromise or negotiate or try to soften it or make it more acceptable or palatable to the people that he was telling it to. He simply delivered God's message clearly, directly, and courageously. God was bringing a drought to the land. Now, remember Baal? I mentioned him earlier. This pagan god who the people had turned toward, the god of storms and the god of rain. And so this bold proclamation that Elijah made was the announcement of a showdown, the direct test of strength between Baal, the god of rain, and the god of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You know, God's people had forsaken the one true God for an idol, and God would not tolerate any rival to his rightful place. You know, God is not some fad or some commodity that we can, you know, move on from today and just cast aside. God does not tolerate any rival to his rightful place. And so we can have confidence that, you know, the God has not gone anywhere. God is not going anywhere. And as we live our lives into the future, God will be there. Doesn't mean that we're going to be popular. How popular do you think that Elijah became all of a sudden? With these few words, he became enemy number one. And it's no different today when we tell people that they're following the wrong path or trusting in the wrong things. None of us should expect to be popular in a world where people have rejected God and his word. In fact, we should expect to be ridiculed and rejected, to say the very least. You know, and many times I think that we compromise the truth of God's word because we're afraid of offending people. We don't like telling people about the sin in their lives or confronting them with biblical truth because we don't want to experience that rejection. And I so much appreciate what our elder candidate said here. You know, getting back to the foundation of God's word. We can't compromise that. As a follower of Jesus, we don't have the right to dilute or soften the truth of God's word in an effort to make it more acceptable to people. And while we should be loving and gracious, we should be more concerned about speaking truth into people's lives than we are about them being offended. What happens next in Elijah's story is, it might surprise us. And the word of the Lord came to him, "Depart from here and turn eastward and hide yourself by the brook of Cherith, which is east of the Jordan." You know, it seems a bit strange here that after confronting Ahab, God told Elijah to go into hiding instead of enabling or empowering him to do battle with Ahab. You'd think that being faithful in service to God, Elijah might have been promoted or thrust into the spotlight. But God had given him a difficult assignment, and he had been faithful in doing what God wanted him to. You know, when we think about being faithful and think, well, you know, if I'm faithful in the little things, doesn't that mean that God will give me abundance? You know, Matthew 25, verse 23 says that. It says, if you are faithful in the little things, God will give you greater things. But that's not talking about fame or glory. It's not talking about a reward. It's talking about responsibility and stewardship. And God doesn't always reward faithfulness in the way that we think he should. But what God does do when we are faithful in the little things is that he gives us assignments that will take greater faith and bring more responsibility. And so when Elijah was faithful in proclaiming this word to Ahab, God began preparing him for something much bigger. God certainly could have protected Elijah here the same way that he did later, but he didn't. You see, Elijah wasn't ready yet for what God had for him next. And the lesson for us to learn here is that every fight isn't a battle. Sometimes we need to step back from a situation because there's something more important that God needs to prepare us for. Not every hill is worth dying on, so choose your hills wisely. But if you are faithful in the small assignments, a time will come when God will use you for something bigger. And even though Elijah was obedient and faithful on this day, his life would become more significant in the days ahead as God prepared him for something more. So I want to encourage you today, whatever your struggle, whatever the situation you might find yourself up against, remember that how you respond prepares you for how you face tomorrow. Thankfully, Elijah's story doesn't end here. If it did, it would be tragic to see him run away. But this was just one chapter of Elijah's life, and it's the same for each one of us. This period in your life, wherever you are and whatever you're dealing with, it's just one scene from your life, from your story. So be faithful in whatever God is calling you to now, and know that through those things that God is preparing you for where he wants to take you tomorrow. Know that God is alive and God is on his throne. God's got this. Stand before him in faith and know his presence in your life. Stand firm no matter what. Speak the truth with boldness and allow God to guide you and prepare you for whatever lies ahead. Let's pray. God, I thank you for the way that you prepared Elijah. I thank you for the message of this servant of yours, Father, who had the faith to know that you are still on your throne. Father, this man who seemed to be in a deep relationship with you and to know your heart, Father, you trusted him with your message. Father, that you guided him every day of his life. And I pray, God, that we would be the same kind of people. Father, that no matter what we're dealing with, the struggles, the changes, the challenges that any of us here face today, give us the confidence, God. Give us the assurance that you're here with us, that you will never leave us or forsake us, God, that you will prepare us, equip us for whatever challenges lay ahead. I pray for Nathaniel and Carson as they think about their future and careers and families, and Father, that you would give them hope. Father, that as parents here today consider the state of the world and think about the future for their children, God, give them the assurance that you are alive and walking with them, that you will prepare them, God, for anything that lies ahead. Father, I pray for strength and boldness for each one of us to proclaim the truth of your world in this culture that seems to have abandoned you. And I thank you that you have not abandoned us. Father, sometimes the message that you give us is difficult and it will be offensive. But Father, give us the wisdom, the boldness. Give us the faith to speak the truth in love. Father, guide us and prepare us for where you want us to go. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand and join us for our final song.
If you're a dad here with us, or maybe your dad's at home and you want a gift for him, we want to give you a gift out on the in the foyer on the little round tables. There's a couple of resources here for dads. I encourage you, take one with you. There's only a limited amount, so first come, first served. But I want to wish, again, all you fathers a happy Father's Day. And this blessing, as you all go, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go in God's peace. Amen.